In this video, we briefly review the processes of cardiac depolarization and repolarization. We will focus only on those points most relevant to understanding the ECG readout. We will work mainly with the 2D schematic of the heart shown here. The schematic shows the right and left atria, a cut through the muscular walls of the right and left ventricles, with the interventricular septum separating the right and left ventricular chambers. The specialized cardiac conducting system is seen here in grey. You will remember from anatomy that the main components of the conducting system are the sinoatrial or SA node situated near the entry of the superior vena cava into the right atrium, and the atrioventricular or AV node leading into the bundle of His. The bundle of His lies in the interventricular septum, where it divides into right and left bundle branches. The right and left bundle branches give rise to a meshwork of terminal fibers in the subendocardium, that is, the myocardium closest to the ventricular lumina. These terminal fibers are capable of releasing electrical signal into the myocardium. During each cardiac cycle, the atria contract in diastole to fill the ventricles, which then contract during systole to supply blood to the lungs and the systemic circulation. Contraction of the atria and ventricles is tightly coordinated by a wave of depolarization spreading through the muscular walls of these chambers. The depolarization wave, seen here in blue, reflects movement of charge across myocyte membranes and is in effect an electrical current spreading through the heart. Following contraction, cardiac muscle returns to a resting state, and this is associated with reversal of the movement of charge across the myocyte membranes. This second wave of electrical activity, seen here in red, is termed cardiac repolarization. The leads of the ECG machine are designed to detect and record these two waves of cardiac electrical activity. The depolarization and repolarization waves spread through the heart in a highly predictable pattern. And to understand the ECG readout, the pattern of spread of cardiac depolarization and repolarization need to be understood. Cardiac depolarization is triggered by an electrical pulse generated in the sinoatrial node. This electrical pulse then spreads through the atria, triggering their depolarization and contraction late in diastole. The atria and ventricles, however, are separated by a non-conducting fibrous septum. The depolarization wave cannot penetrate this barrier, and in order to activate ventricular contraction, the wave must be transmitted into the ventricles by the specialized cardiac conducting system. In a normal heart, the only route by which the depolarizing wave can enter the ventricular conducting system is through the AV node. In order to allow the ventricles to fill with blood following atrial contraction, the AV node initially delays the spread of the depolarization wave. After this short delay, the depolarizing signal is transmitted into the ventricles via the bundle of His. The right and left bundle branches then transmit the depolarizing signal into the muscle mass of the right and left ventricles respectively. We should note at this point that depolarizing current is first released from the conducting system into the myocardium of the interventricular septum. Therefore, this structure is the first part of the ventricular muscle mass to depolarize, and it does so by movement of current across the septum from the left towards the right bundle branch. We'll see later that this early left to right movement of current in the interventricular septum is crucial to understanding several important ECG abnormalities. As septal depolarization is taking place, the depolarizing wave is released from the conducting system into the main mass of the right and left ventricles. As you can see here, the depolarization wave is initially released from the terminal branches of the conducting system into the subendocardial portion of the ventricular myocardium. That is the part closest to the luminal surface of the ventricles. Crucially, depolarization then spreads outwards from the subendocardial to the epicardial surface of the chambers. Appreciation of this subendocardial to epicardial movement of depolarization in the ventricular walls is crucial to understanding the normal ECG readout. In contrast to depolarization, cardiac repolarization is not truly propagated between cells. However, cardiac myocytes repolarize at different rates, depending on their anatomical location within the heart. Within the ventricular wall, there is a gradient in the rate of cellular repolarization. Cells in the epicardial region have the fastest rate of repolarization and repolarize first following ventricular contraction. The rate of cellular repolarization is then progressively slower as we move from the epicardium towards the endocardium. Therefore, perhaps counterintuitively, repolarization spreads through the ventricles in the opposite direction to the depolarization wave. As illustrated here, following ventricular depolarization, repolarization begins in the epicardium and spreads backwards from the epicardial to the endocardial surface of the ventricles. We'll see later that this retrograde spread of ventricular repolarization is important in understanding the normal ECG readout. We will now go on in video 2 to show you how the depolarization and repolarization waves are analyzed to produce the normal ECG readout.